So, hi everyone. So as of now, we have seen shared memory programming model. Now we'll talk about distributed memory parallelism. So that means now we can enable our program to run on multiple machines. So we have a code which can spawn across multiple machines. So with shared memory, we had seen that we are limited to a node, and but that limitation had some benefits also, like ease of programming and like incremental parallelization and so on. With respect to MPI, it's we have a certain paradigm shift with respect to MPI because it is distributed memory. There is lot of flexibility available in this, so that's why it involves slightly more programming into that. And MPI is one of the de facto standard for writing parallel programs in HPC industry. So there are hundreds of applications used worldwide for various simulations, which are very widely used, and most of these they are written using MPI. And as a matter of fact, the top supercomputers, they are also ranked using programs which are benchmark programs, and they make use of MPI to run on it. So this is how they are ranked. Okay. So the contents are, we'll just browse through some general concepts. Then we'll see message passing model, so general distributed memory kind of programming model, and then we'll see what is MPI, MPI point-to-point communication, and data types. Okay. So this is serial versus parallel flow, where in left side we have a serial program, and so we can take example from our yesterday's programming lab session, wherein we added billion elements, right? So if we do that, so in the serial program, how it happens, we'll declare our variables and so on, then we'll generate our inputs, then we'll do the computation and we'll produce results. In parallel, there are certain extra steps which are required. As of now, we are now quite suited to understand what are these extra steps, what we need to do. Shared memory programming, we had seen the communication was implicit, so we didn't actually say that we are doing any communication. It was doing behind the scenes. Whenever there was certain dependencies, we are doing synchronization and so on. So, but in MPI, since it's process-based parallelism, so every process has its own memory address space. So that means one process cannot share the address space of other process. So that means whatever communication has to happen, that has to explicitly happen from the process side. Then only we will be able to share results among themselves. So communication is one of the major integral part of MPI kind of parallelism. You have to communicate. So we can consider these as overheads also, but we cannot do away with it. So we have to identify how the work has to be divided across processes, and then actually that data had to be sent to processes. Let's say we have a process which is generating its own data, or it is reading from a file, and then that process will supply or data to different processes, whatever are relevant to them. Then each of them will kind of asynchronously do the computation. That means independently they'll do it, and whenever they would require, they can talk to each other. MPI provides that mechanism through which they can talk to each other, and then finally we can get the results at one place. right? And so so getting the results again, that's a communication part. Intermediate, whenever they talk to each other, that is also communication part. So all this is done through using MPI. Okay. So when we have a parallel processes, so we can see like here when input is created, here we are creating the input by only one process. So other processes, they are idle, and once they get data, then only they'll this pink part represents that the data is being communicated to them. So we will have calls through which data will be shared to them, and then they'll do their computations, local computations, and then finally we'll collect the results from them. And again, one process may write it to the file. So now, one of the drawbacks here, we can upfront, what we can see is that the other than one, all processes, they are idle, right, when the input is being generated. So this can limit your scalability, right? Scalability means how much you can like run your same program with same input data set on a larger machine. So as we go larger, so what happens, the amount of computation done by per process, that goes down. And so, but this is constant, right? So the ratio becomes, so the computation to communication ratio or the overheads ratio, that keeps on going down. So because of which we get limited scalability. So yesterday also in summation of numbers, we saw that when we had not parallelized the initialization part, we are not getting speed up. We are just getting marginal speed up with that. So same thing happens here also. We have to parallelize the input part also. So for small programs or for like smaller sized runs, this may be okay, provided your computation, you spend good enough time in computation with respect to your input time. Otherwise, you have to go for parallelization. Okay. So here, we can do away with the initial communication part, wherein we are sharing data across processes, input data. Now, the output part, so again, it is happening in serial. So we would wish that we can parallelize the output part also. So it is doable, but many a times for we have to take a call whether it's worth our efforts or not. And so input is easily parallelizable because it is read only, right? We are reading only. Output is write. So if you are writing to a common file, so although you can do that in parallel through multiple processes, and I think tomorrow's talk will also cover that. So, but that becomes more complex to program. And secondly, like you must have certain things like parallel file system, high performance storage, and all to complement that. Otherwise, you'll do it in parallel, but that won't physically happen in parallel. So it won't translate to speed ups. So just we'll touch upon some performance metrics to have a better idea of like what is our objective in this. So speed up, we all know it's sequential time divided by parallel time. And so we always expect our speed up to be near to number of parallel processes which are running. Then we have efficiency, which is speed up on P processes divided by number of processes. So it gives us the efficiency or effective utilization per process that we are doing. Yesterday we were seeing that in one of the programs, I think submission program, we were like on 20, on 40 cores, we are getting 20 times the speed up, right? So that was kind of 50% efficiency. Though the speed up was 20 here, but the efficiency was 20 divided by 40 number of processes. So it was 0.5. So always while running our programs or while writing our programs, we have to understand like how long it will be efficient, on what size of the machine it would be efficient. So because we have limited resources which are shared across users, so we must be aware of such thing. Then there is Amdahl's law, which is good for if we are attempting parallelization of a serial code. So it gives us an estimate of what speed up can we expect from the parallelization of the serial code. So if we consider certain parts of the code, like initialization of the input, writing to output files, which we don't intend to parallelize right away, so we can consider them as the serial part, and we can take that fraction of execution time spent in with respect to the total execution time spent in a serial program, and with that fraction we can like understand what is the maximum speed up that we can get on any number of processes. So this is the fraction of the sequential portion. So denominator is the time taken by the parallel program, and time taken by the serial program we consider as one unit. So a fraction f of that will anyways be spent because it's serial. Remaining 1 minus f can be parallelized, right? So if it is ideally parallelized, so we get this much timing for that part, and so overall we get this much speed up. So if we consider that we have a sequential fraction 0.1 and we have 10 processes, so the maximum speed up is 5, and even if we have very high number of processes, then also we cannot go beyond 10 times speed up, right? So this sets our initial estimation of what speed up we can expect. But this is not like a final picture, because it depends upon a lot of things, like our input size also. So let's say we increase our input size, and with that we'll see like probably the computation will grow faster, the computational time will grow faster with respect to your initialization time and the input handling time, right? So in that case, this fraction would decrease and you'll get higher speed ups. So generally, in let's say if we take example of matrix multiplication, where we do multiply two matrices, so the multiplication part consists of three loops, which is of order of cubic complexity, and while we are initializing the data, that is of order of square, right? So for that two-dimensional matrix. So the ratio of computation to communication or input size or initialization part, we can so in that program would be n, so which will keep on increasing as we have higher matrix dimension, right? So this portion would keep on decreasing. So we have to practically choose the input when we are attempting parallelization, what we are expecting. If we choose a small input, so obviously we may not get the correct estimate. Then there are communication overheads. So why are we talking about communication overheads? Because here now the physically message from one process memory has to be transferred to other process's memory, right, for sharing of data. So when it has to go physically, so it has to get transferred over the wire, it has to get transferred within a box, or it may have to get transferred over a external network, right? Multiple nodes, they are connected through external network, so it has to go through that. So now with respect to MPI, we always consider like node-to-node latencies, like a message being sent from one node to another, what is the latency? So latency is in terms of microsecond, and the bandwidth for transfer is 100 gigabits per second, so which is for the high-end interconnection networks like InfiniBand. So we have to understand here that the amount of computation per time step, generally we have iterative process inside our parallel program, and so the amount of time is spent before they do any communication, so that should be substantially higher with respect to these times. And so because if they start becoming comparable, you'll hit a wall for speed up. characteristics of message passing model. So it's asynchronous parallelism. We all that the processes, they are quite independent. There is no race condition. They can do it independently. Then they have their own memory address spaces. Then we require sharing of data through explicit calls to MPI through which data transfer would happen. And then we explicitly identify how work has to be divided across processes and how data has to be divided across processes. So how message passing works is like we have a parallel computation which consists of number of processes, and these processes, they have their own address space. Now whenever we want to share data from one process to another process, so there is no direct mechanism for that. So that has to be done through explicitly passing messages. And it requires a cooperative operation. Say I have process one, process two, they want to talk to each other. So so they have to be like do it collectively. That means if process one is ready to send something and process two is not ready to receive it, so process one will be waiting for it and the transaction won't complete. So it won't happen. So that means it's a collective operation. And then, so we can run our MPI programs on any machine. So even on a single processor also, we can run it, single core, we can run it. So of course, we'll not get performance. They'll time share the CPU, but we can check the correctness of our program. So you all have laptops, like if you want to use MPI, so you can just download some MPI version. Maybe if possible, I'll show you. And you can have MPI installed on your system and you can write programs. You may not see benefit, much benefit, but you can see the correctness of your implementation. Usefulness of this model. So it's an extremely general model. So as I said, like most of the real world HPC applications, they are implemented using this model. It's because of its generality. Almost any type of computations, they can be implemented using MPI. Then it's quite versatile. You can you have a program, you can run it on any kind of infrastructure, like any kind of interconnect, any kind of machines, because most of these they are already having support for MPI. And MPI allows more control over data location and flow with respect to our shared memory models, wherein we could encounter race condition and so on. So here we have a much higher control of our data. And of course, we can expect performance. We are not talking of exascale and so on. So of course, that is because of the performance that we can expect from such programming models. So what is MPI? So it stands for Message Passing Interface. And again, like OpenMP, it's kind of a specification, guidelines, which any implementation would follow so that it is portable. Once I have written a program, I can choose any implementation and it should run like consistently on other platforms also. So it's now we can see we can consider them as different nodes. Like we are doing hands-on on compute nodes CN01, CN02, and so on. We can consider them as different nodes CN01, CN02, and so on. Now our single MPI enabled program that would be able to run on multiple nodes of our system. So, and every hardware, major hardware vendor, they have their own implementations. Like we know, there are like HPC OEMs who provide HPC servers, like IBM, Intel, HP, Dell, so on. So they, all of them have their own MPI implementations, so that which are optimized for their platforms. But you can work on their system with other platforms, other implementations also. And of course, MPI can be run on anywhere. Like we can have multiple laptops if they are connected through some network. So we can even like run programs on them. So even here now you are on a common network, if you install like MPI on two different laptops, irrespective of like what OS, they should be like, OS should be common. Like if you are running Linux here, you should run Linux. But it's not necessary that if you are running Ubuntu here, so it should be Ubuntu only. It can be different flavor for that. And you can have MPI program running on both of them. So is MPI large or small? If we go by the number of functions, it's quite large. As you know, since it's able to scale application, that means a lot of stuff go behind the scenes to optimize the application at whatever extent possible. So it has lots of features. And with every release, we see lots of new enhancements coming into it. Then MPI is small also, in a sense that there are six basic MPI functions or calls, which if we understand, so we can easily parallelize our application with that. When I say easily, that is because that putting it or using it inside the for parallelizing the program would not be that difficult. Of course, we'll have to apply the logic, how we have to apply parallelism. That means how we have to think of decomposing our work data. But from the calls perspective, they are quite simple to use. And then, so we can use start with these, and then later on, as we fine-tune our application, we can go for more complex calls to have a better performance of it. Okay, so how this model works is let's say we have different machines. They are on a communication network, and a common program that is supposed to run on multiple machines. So once we have compiled the program and we launch it from one place, so we have its instance running on different distributed machines. And now the MPI calls, they would create the environment through which these multiple processes, they can talk to each other, they can send data, receive data, and so on. And each process will have a unique identifier associated with it. It's called rank of it. Earlier, yesterday also we see in OpenMP that threads have ranks. But since many a times in OpenMP we were using loop level parallelism, wherein we were not quite required to use the ranks and all. But here in MPI, it's predominantly based on ranks only. So always you will see that without ranks, you will not be able to proceed. So it's always that you have to make use of, identify the unique number associated with all the process. Here also we have ranks starting from 0 till n minus 1. To communicate together, multiple processes, so they require ranks. All distribution decisions, they are based on ranks. Then we have point-to-point communication. That means one-to-one communication, wherein you have several processes from a given program or job, and process rank 0 wants to talk to rank 4. So this will be called a point-to-point communication. So there is a source process, there is a destination process, and there is a term called communicator. So communicator, as the name suggests, that they enable communication between these processes, right? So we'll see slightly more about it. So now we have collective communication. So in collective communication, it's one-to-many, many-to-many, many-to-one. It can be either way. So that means multiple processes, and not only multiple processes, rather all processes would be involved in it. We cannot say that we are involving only 3 of them, we are not involving 2 of them. So we will involve all processes within this communicator to do the collective communication, right? There is a term called MPI-COM world, which is a communicator, a default communicator. So when we launch our program, so by default, environment or a communication channel among processes that is enabled, which is represented by MPI-COM world. Now, what are communicators? So communicators, they are handles to our groups of processes. So let's say I have this default, I have these five processes in my parallel job, and these five processes, so by default, they'll be under the umbrella of MPI-COM world. And now, I said that I can do point-to-point communication, I can do collective communication. So what if I want to talk only between a subset of multiple processes, right? I want to talk to only a subset. So so there I cannot do the collective operation, which we saw earlier, because it has to engage all the processes. And then we'll have to do point-to-point in iterative fashion, or several times we'll have to make call, which would not be efficient. So there is provision for like making a subset of these processes. So like we can, there are several mechanisms through which we can segregate them, these processes. So so this is required for like you have task kind of parallelism. So within you identify certain processes which have to work on a common task, and then within this task also we can have like domain decomposition or data level parallelism. Right? So, okay. So one of the examples I can give here is like in real applications, like in climate applications, we have atmospheric model, we have ocean model, we have land model, and so on. So all these models, they are independent, they can be run independently, but to have a climate simulation, they need to talk to each other. So at that highest level, we can see that these different ocean atmospheric models, they are representing task parallelism, and with and within these they'll have again they can have heterogeneous levels of parallelism, and so on they can have again multiple subgroups of these processes. So now in this, when I let's say I choose this three purples ones, so again when I make a new communicator out of it, so they would be ranked from starting from 0 to n minus 1 number of processes within that communicator, and I would name this communicator like as COM1. So and again I can choose any of these processes, so it's not necessary that we have to do disjoint subset, they can be overlapping, any one process can belong to multiple communicators, but it would possibly have different ranks among different communicators. So building blocks of MPI. Now this is the most important part of MPI, the send and receive call, wherein like your data sharing would happen across processes. So when we say send and receive, it's a point-to-point communication. Now whatever I'm talking about in this lecture would be point-to-point communication. So that means only one process is talking to other process. Now in point-to-point communication, like in send and receive, there are some important parameters that have to be set while making these calls. So it's like the data that we want to share, so that data will go here. Let's say I have an array, and how many elements from this array I would like to share, so it has to go there, and which rank I want to send it to. So this is kind of pseudo call. It's not the complete, it has more number of parameters. Basically, it has six parameters. So these are the most important ones that we have to take care of. Then similarly, at the receiving side, we have the corresponding parameters. So receiver will receive in what data element, in what variables, and how many elements and source. So this has to match. So we must know, see here, that the number of elements here at the sender side is not known at the receiver side, because they have their own, they have these variables existing in their own space, right? So this value is not visible to receiver side. But while programming, we know it, how much we are intending, because we are writing the sender also, we are writing the receiver also. So we must, we know. And so accordingly, we must have the consistent value on both the sides. Now, completion means that whenever, you see, I am sending my data, it doesn't necessarily means when I say MPI send, so data is immediately sent, because the system may be busy, the communication network may be busy, the receiver may not be ready, it may be engaged in something else, so because of which the data transfer would not have happened. So until that time, it would not be safe to modify that data, right? So if we modify the data and later on the actual communication happens, so it may so wrong result may be sent. So the completion means that at the sender side, it is safe to use the buffer whose value or whose data was being sent previously. Then there are several MPI communication modes, and they depend, of course, they depend upon the performance reason. We'll just briefly touch them also in later slide. Then broadly, we can classify the communication into blocking and non-blocking. We'll see what it means. So a blocking operation, it's like, say this sender wants to send certain information over the network, and it is sending it, and after it has posted it, the sender is waiting there, right, for the message to be received. And once he sees that the message is actually received here, so once it is received here, then he would be free. So then he can make changes to that pad, notepad, right? So blocking, we can see from here, unless and until the message is sent, we are not free to do changes to that buffer, right? So when I say message being sent, doesn't necessarily means that it is getting received. So there are several variants to that, we'll discuss that, but we have to be ensured that it is safe to modify the buffer now. That is what is meant by blocking operation. Non-blocking, so non-blocking, as the name suggests, it doesn't block. As soon as I have invoked this call, I can go past it, I can do any work, and so it's our responsibility that we unintentionally doesn't modify the data which was being sent, unless and until we are sure that it was actually transferred. So here it is, it has posted it, it doesn't wait for it to get received, it will get busy with some work, and then later on, it's our responsibility that whenever now he wants to make changes to that, he should verify that whether it was received or not. So we see that here also, there are overheads of verifying whether it was received or not. So, but if that time lag is big, we know that. So then we can go for non-blocking, because we can do some other stuff, and later on we can check and proceed with modifying that data. So point to point, so it for this communication to happen, we require certain information which has to be passed, then only this communication would happen. So so we must know which process is sending the message. So whenever we say sender and receiver, so we need to identify the sender and receiver also, right? So let's say I'm running with my job with 4 processes. I want to talk to, so 0 wants to send something to rank 3. So in that case, I must know that I am 0. And so I'll say if my rank is 0, send to rank 3. And rank 3 also must have corresponding receive. It will say that if I am 3, receive it from 0. So it has to be kind of handshake between the two. So we must know which process is sending, where the data is on the sending process. So we pass the address of the buffer, or we pass it by reference in Fortran. And then what kind of data, what data type we are sending, and how many elements of that data type we are sending. So this is important, because through this it calculates how many bytes it has to transfer. So we are mentioning the data type and how many elements of. So with this it will calculate how many bytes of data is to be transferred. Then what is the receiver rank, and in what variable at the receiver side it has to be copied to. And again, so receiver also has number of elements and data type. So how much data it is able to receive. So then, so ideally it should be same at both the side. So this is the general flow of an MPI program. So header file, we initialize MPI environment, we do the work, we make MPI calls for communication, and we terminate the MPI environment. So when we terminate the MPI environment, our parallel processes would still exist. So that doesn't mean that I have terminated my processes. I have just terminated my MPI environment. So these processes can still exist. They can still do work, but they won't be able to talk to each other, right? So they don't can't do any computation, communication. So header file is mpi.h, mpif.h, and the format is in C, it is case sensitive, so MPI in capital underscore, the first letter of this word would be capital, and then the remaining name, and then the parameter list, and it returns a error code in integer data type. Similarly in Fortran, so we have like subroutine calls, and it returns the return value inside the parameter of Fortran. So this is the format of Fortran. Okay, so we had said that MPI is easy or small to start with. There are 6 basic functions to MPI, and we can expect quite a good parallel program using these 6 functions only. So MPI init, this does the initialization of MPI environment. So initialization involves lot of things like setting up of communication buffers and mechanism. So it will create your communicator. So now processes can talk to each other. They'll have ranks assigned to them. So but they have ranks assigned to them, but we have to get the rank value through this call. Otherwise my process would not know what rank it has. That rank has been assigned to it, but we must get that value in some variable inside the process, for which we'll call the this function MPI com rank. Then MPI finalize is there, so it terminates the MPI environment, after which we cannot do any MPI calls. Total number of processes, then send and receive. So initializing MPI, so in C we pass the command line arguments to this, and we can also pass null to it. It not mandatory, and it's MPI underscore init, I is capital here. Then we can find out how many processes are there, because once we have compiled, we can run it with a varying number of processes. So inside the program, to know how many processes we have, because accordingly we'll divide our work across processes. So this is useful for that. And here we have the communicator, MPI com, right? So by default, what is the communicator name? Yes. So MPI com world will go here, unless and until we have defined our own communicators, so that name will go. and then we have this address passed to it, and now this will contain the total number of processes. So every process must call this. It's not mandatory to call it, but to do any useful work, we have to call it so that they get to know how many processes are there. Then similarly, we have rank, MPI.com rank, and variable for rank is passed here. Rank starts from 0 to n minus 1. Then finalize is there, and it will terminate, clean up the MPI environment. Now, this is a small hello program for MPI. So we have the header file here, and we have passed these arguments for command line arguments for main, and then we have init, rank, size. So in rank we see we have defined a variable as rank and we pass its address. Similarly in size, and we do some work here and we finalize the MPI environment. So this is the four calls which we have to work with most of the time when we use. So init and finalize are must. Without init, your program would have like compilation error itself. Now, how do we compile it? So this command will be slightly different. We'll talk about it when we go to hands-on. And while running, we use a launcher for that. So this will, now we'll pass the number of processes to this, let's say four processes and the executable. So now four instances of my executable will be created, and it depends upon like where they go, whether we are running, we want to run it on one machine, or we want to run it on four machines, or we want to run two on two machines, right? So it's up to us how we want to spawn it. Then send. So it has six parameters we have talked, and so this is how it has to be done. So let's say we have integer array and a is there. So if it's like, so we can, since it's an array, we can directly put a here, right? And then we can say how many number of elements we want to send to, what data type. So we'll see. So we cannot simply say like int here because MPI has its own data type. So which are generally for primitive data types, it has wrappers, and that is for the like portability. So on some system like you may have int as 2 bytes, on some system you may have int as 4 bytes. So if you use MPI int, you are assured that it is using 4 bytes on both the systems. So it is for portability. Then destination, rank, that means where I want to send. Then a tag value. So tag value is important because through this we can differentiate between two processes. Let's say my all other parameters are same. Of course, this let's say I'm sending A index 0 here, and in the next call I'm sending A index 1. Value here, and so all other parameters would be same here. Yes, because let's say we are sending it to a given rank. So how do we distinguish between these two messages, right? So it's the tag value which we should provide distinct values in these two calls, so that we have a mechanism to be ensured that the two messages doesn't mangle up. We'll see that in hands-on also. Then we have the communicator name. This is must, that which communicator they belong to, because processes can talk to each other in context of communicator only. So so there is always a global communicator, MPI.com world default, which is there, in which through which we can talk from any process to any process. But if we have defined our own communicators, we want to talk only within them. So we'll use that communicator. And so again, their ranks will be relative to that communicator. Then similarly, at the receive side, we must have a buffer wherein we want to receive the count, data type. Now we have source here from where we'll get the value. And matching tag, so the sender and the receiver tag values, they should match. Otherwise, the transaction won't complete and your program will be hung up. Then communicator, then there is additional parameter with respect to send. This status, it's a structure data type. In C, it has its relevance, we'll touch that. Okay, so wildcards, so now when we talk about send and receive, we say that I'm sending this to this rank, I'm receiving it from this rank, and so on. So let's say I am a process, I want to get data from several other processes, right? Let's say several other processes, they have done their partial submission, and I am supposed to get all these partial values from other processes. So I am supposed to receive from them. So one way is that I put a loop, I'll put a for loop inside which I'll say MPI receive, and then I'll, through the loop index, I'll say the ranks of the threads, that if loop index is I is equal to 1, let me receive it from rank 1. Also, we can put that logic. So, but this will kind of hard code a sequence. We are going it in a sequence, but it may happen that some other rank is ready to send its data prior to rank 1 or so. So we can make use of wildcards to have that, to avoid this sequential pattern in that. So we can say inside our receive call that I am ready to receive from any source. It can have any tag value also. So we are programming it, and we know like that whether we are doing it right or not. So we are responsible. Then if at any later point I want to know from where I had received it, from which process had actually sent it, which rank, if for some reason I require it. So there is in MPI receive, we had seen the last parameter as status. So that status, status here. So this will hold the value of from where we had received it. But this should not have been overwritten by another receive call. Right? If another receive call is posted, so that status will be overwritten. So we can say status.tag, MPI underscore tag, we'll get its value, MPI source, MPI error. So message data type. We had said that MPI provides its own data type names or data type, which we have to use. So these data types are primitive data types as well as user-defined data types. User can like define their own data type. Let's say you want to define your own structure, which you want to use it, right? So you will not always want to, let's say your structure has certain integer variables, certain float variables, and so on. So you'll have to use two call for sending these two different data types. Rather than that, if you are using it frequently, you will want to create your own data type, and so that they can be sent in one go. So these are the basic data types, like MPI char, MPI short, MPI int, and so on. So they are all in capital for C. In Fortran case, can be anything. So this is the send call. I think we have already covered. So this is an example of it. Let's say I have a data array, and I want to send its data. I want to send 500 elements from this. So when I say data, so starting from its zeroth element, base address, my 500 elements would be sent. So 500 multiplied by float take 4 bytes. So 2000 bytes of data would be sent from zeroth address. But let's say I want to send from certain offset. So that I can mention here. So let's say I want to start from the 10th element. So I'll say ampersand data 9 in the subscript, right? So address of the 10th element. So it will start from there, and again it will send 500 elements starting from there. And which rank. So rank 5 I want to send to. There is the tag value. So at the receiver side, same tag value should be posted, and the communicator. Similarly, at the receive side, so it is saying I am receiving from rank 3, same tag value, and extra parameter is status. Now there are several variants of send calls. So these are required for performance reasons. So the send we have seen is called a standard send. And then there is synchronous send. Synchronous means that let us first discuss more about the standard send. So standard send, these are all these calls, they are blocking calls, and so that means it always ensures that data is safely copied or is safe to modify when the call completes. So so immediately after the call, we can modify the data, and we are assured that there won't be any overwriting or unintended data sharing. So what happens in MPI send? By default, there is some communication buffers, intermediate buffers, which are provided by MPI environment. So when we say send, so that data would be copied to that buffer if the receiver is not ready to receive it. So what happens when that data is copied from process address space to a buffer? So the process is now, sender process is now free to modify that data, even though the receiver has yet not received it, right? So that data has been safely copied outside this. So we see that this is fast because of that. But again, there are overheads also, because there is extra overhead because of copying it to a different buffer, right? But in synchronous send, what happens that it has to be received, then only this call will complete. Otherwise, the process would, sender process would be waiting there. So the receiver should actually receive it if we have such need. So it should be. Then buffered send is like, we talked about intermediate communication buffer, but that is quite small in size. If we want bigger data and to be buffered, because in our program, we are not certain that the receiver would have posted or not the receive call because of irregular computations. We are not certain at what time. So we can have user-defined buffers in which we can place our send data in transition. And this call would complete then. Then a ready send. So ready send is when we know the receiver has posted this call before the send was invoked at this site. So it means that the receiver was already ready to actually receive it. Then for all of these, we can have MPI receive, because this is at the source side, sender side. We want to optimize it, because it happens that sender is ready, but the receiver has got delayed, because of which sender process is idle. And so they have a corresponding receive calls for that. So similar variants of these send, they exist for non-blocking also. We are not discussing that. And they may not be that commonly used. So for a communication to succeed, sender must specify valid destination rank, must specify source rank, receiver must specify. Communicator must be same for the two, send and receive, tags must match. Receiver's buffer must be large. So if it is not large, probably we'll not get to know that unless and until we capture the return value from the call. So it returns integer, and in that it will return like how many elements it has actually received. So unless and until we check, we don't know whether, let's say I have an array here. At the sender side, I am sending 10 elements of that array. At the receiver side, I only say, I provide an array of 5 elements. So, of course, there would be overflow, but the program won't halt or like fail because of that. It's our responsibility to see that the data was actually fully copied. So in buffered call, buffered send call, again, the user-defined buffer should be big enough. So receive posted before send, we have already discussed. It's required for ready send only. Now, there can be a scenario for deadlocks in this. So deadlocks, so here we have process 0 and process 1. Both are sending some data to each other. Process 0 is also sending, process 1 is also sending. So what happens that in the blocking send, we will have a deadlock because this will wait until the process, other process receives it, right? So but would it always happen that there is a deadlock if such scenario is there? Pardon? There will be always be, okay. So it depends like what is the size of this data. We talked that there is some common buffer available through the environment, MPI environment, in which these blocking send data type gets copied. So if the data type, if the size is small, it can get copied there, you won't see the deadlock. But if the size is big, then you will get the deadlock. So you can try this in program also. Any questions? Receive call would, so the return value would be number of that.
But for the data collected, say for example, I send one, but I receive two.
Pardon, come again?
Say for example, I was sending just one integer.
Okay. So first of all, because of any external conditions, it won't receive. But because like you may have that value in the number of elements modified because of some reasons. So you intended it to be one at the receiver side, but it got two. So so in that case, I don't think it should be issue because you are intending to send one element and one element would be anyways copied there. So that extra space is there, which is left out, so which was not.
Yes. Okay, so like when we are implementing this message passing interface on the network, do we also like then need to specify the underlying socket program to it, or is that implicitly?
Yes, so that is implicitly. So MPI is higher level programming interface. So which would underlying it would rely on such things. So that would implicitly happen. So all inter-process communication things they'll like happen under the hood. So. We don't directly use that. So we'll go through a hello world. And this is mpi.h. Then we define variables which will hold values of their ranks, number of processes, receiver rank, sender rank, and so on. Then we have MPI init, which initializes the MPI environment. We must pass these arguments. We can also pass null to them. Then we have MPI com rank, in which we pass this rank variable. We can have any name. Then MPI size, and we printf. So how do I compile MPI ICC? I can also use MPI CC. So with four processes, ranks, and total number of processes. So in principle, we can run with any number of processes, but it's worth to have number of processes equal to like mapping your physical resources. Then only like for compute bound application, we'll be able to see performance. Okay, now let's see MPI send and receive. So here we have rank not equal to 0. So that means other than rank 0, all processes would run this. And then we have some message in which we are copying this message to this buffer. And then we intend to send these messages to rank 0 process. So my destination is root I have defined as 0 earlier, and then I have given a destination tag. We have taken it as 0. Then I do the send call, and in send I pass this message because it's already a character array, so we don't need to put ampersand. Now the buffer size, so how many elements of this that was defined earlier, what type it is, character, MPI underscore care, where I want to send it. So it will go to this, it was declared initialized as 0 earlier, so it will go to 0 rank, and then what tag value and the com world. So this is the syntax for send. And so all this is inside rank 0, right? So no other processes will be running it. Similarly, at the receiver side, which is in else part, which will be executed, so this was for all processes which were not rank 0, they are sending to rank 0. So rank 0 would execute the else part, and since it has to receive from multiple processes, so one way is that I receive multiple calls, each with different source ranks. Other ways I put it in iteration. So I'll put a for loop because I want to receive from multiple other ranks. So inside this, I have called the MPI receive. Now here the source value would be the value of this index. So it can be anything. It's up to us how we define it. So here one way is we are using the loop index variable for defining from where I am receiving it, right? So rank 0 would receive from, in the first iteration, it would receive from rank 1. Next iteration, it would receive from 2, and so on. And this status parameter. So when we compile and run such programs, so let's say I run it with 4 ranks. So every rank will have all of these data associated with them, and they are their own data, right? So rank 0 is printing it, that the messages it received from other ranks, right? Hello world from rank 1, hello world from rank 2, and so on. So this is from the rank 0 side, which is printing it. Any questions on this? Because this is the most important part of MPI. If you are able to handle these 6 calls, we know what parameters are there and how they should be placed, how if conditions has to be used. So we are good to go for writing MPI parallelism in our application. In this, yes. So we are running it on the same, and but when I say like 4, it doesn't necessarily means it will run on this system only. It depends upon my allocation, how I have like acquired these resources. Let's say I have acquired it through some scheduling thing in which we have acquired multiple nodes. So it can happen that like that scheduling itself is aware of like how to spawn it. It would, so there will be a default way in which like it will try to scatter your application so as to maximize the availability of resource. So they can go to different nodes also. But right now it is physically going to only one node. Then let us see the status. So where we said like what wildcards it has, so it can give the value of wildcards. So again, here I have rank 3. It is sending some data to rank 1. Now let's say at the rank 1 side, we don't want to say that it should receive from 3. We want to say that it should receive from any rank. Let's say other ranks are searching something, and if they find something, then only they'll post it to rank 1. And so rank 1 doesn't know from which it is going to receive. But it knows that it will receive from one of them because their other ranks are doing it. So in that scenario also, MPI any source would make sense. So for performance reason also, and for such unknown where we don't know from which rank we are going to receive. But now we want to know from which rank. So we can find out the value of this through this. So MPI receive has this status variable here, status object here. So status is a structure, and it has these members, MPI source, MPI tag. So we can retrieve the value of these members. So here you see that receiver side, this tag value is 30, and the sender rank is 3. Oh, sorry, the tag value is 101, and the sender rank is 3. So that is what is given in the if condition. So here we see rank 3 was had sent it, and with a tag value of 101, right? So we didn't put any numbers here, and it was able to receive. So while hands-on, you can like change these values. You can change the tag value. You can see change the rank value, and you can check that it is able to receive anonymously from the other, from the sender. Then we have tag, and so why tag is required? Suppose I have a sender and I have one receiver, and from this sender I want to send 2 messages to the receiver side. So it may happen that due to some reason, my second message arrives first, so it should not, so it would violate my intention, right? So I can have different tag values, and through which, like, I'll ensure that only when the matching tag is posted, I'll receive it. So here, if you see, one process, rank 0, is sending two data elements to rank 1. So it is sending through two different calls. So in this call, age is sent, one element of type int to rank 1, tag value this, and MPI comworld. And similarly, weight is being sent with different tag value. Now at the receiver side, intentionally, I have swapped these tag values, and it is 201 first and 101 first, but I have kept the order of receive buffer as same, right? At the receiver side, these receive buffer names can be different, but like for understanding, generally, we keep the name same. So, and now we'll print what receiver has received. So sent message was age 30, but received message is 870. So the two have swapped, right? So we must correct it. So will I get right result now? Because, okay, it's 201, okay. Right? Okay. So then we have certain assignments, and you can go through them. So it's in the same directory. And then a third assignment is like parallelization of matrix-matrix multiplication. So yesterday we had seen matrix serial program, we had seen OpenMP. Now you can attempt to parallelize this matrix multiplication after you have gone through other programs, right? So at the end, I'll just discuss how to, what is the approach to do that, a simple naive approach for doing the parallelization, but I'll not give the code of that. You have to do it. Then there are compilation commands given at the end, like how you can compile and how you can run. Then we have another programs. So I'll go through one of the programs, like buffered send call. So we'll demonstrate what is the use of buffered send call. So here I have 100 elements, and I am sending this 100 elements to rank 1. Rank 1 has some sleep at its side. And then after that sleep, it will actually receive it. Now, at the sender side, I am outputting time just before the send call and just after the send call. So I am seeing like what weight the sender is going through. So we have put a sleep at the receiver side, but we see though the program took time because the receiver was to complete, then only it will finish up. But at the sender side, there was no waiting after the sent call, right? It was immediately completed. So this is the time, like 15, 25 minutes, 40 seconds. So it was immediately completed. Now let us increase that buffer size. So again, we see that it has immediately completed the sender. That means the sender was free to modify the data immediately after posting the sent call in this case. I'll increase the buffer further. So now we see the wait is happening. And that is for 5 seconds, right? So now the system provided buffer, which MPI environment is providing, that is not big enough to hold that element. So because of this blocking sent call, it has to wait. And if we know that this is a regular pattern in our program, we have to send big data and the receiver is not may not be ready most of the times. So we can have our own user defined buffer for that. And with that, we'll have to use buffered sent call. So now we'll create our own buffer. And so I have already provisioned a buffer space. Now we have to connect it to MPI, right? So that space is already provisioned in memory. So whatever n is there, so plus 10, because some extra space is also required, otherwise it will throw error. Then I'll say, MPI buffer attach, and what is the variable name that was having that space, and what is the size of it, that buffer. So it was of type integer, and so 4 bytes into the number of elements that buffer is holding. So that I'll attach here. And so if I do that, still my wait will be still there because I have not used the appropriate call. So MPI, we have used MPI send only, but instead we have to use MPI bsend, buffered send. So it says insufficient space in buffered send. I'll just increase it slightly again. So 100 element space extra. And now we see that there is no wait, right? The user defined buffer is being used. Similarly, there are other variants of blocking sent calls also. They have their own relevance. So you can copy these. So at some point later, I'll go through the calculation of value of pi. So not right now. You try these programs yourself right now. You also go through the assignments and later we'll I'll touch these programs. Yes. So to copy, again it is in temp aws mpi to your home directory, and not your home directory, your home folder, your folder. You can open that file and you will come to know like what assignments you have. On Shrestha, on the login node only of Shrestha.
is not in the home it is
in the home
slash temp AWS MPI as also. First assignment. So is the assignment clear? Add ranks of all odd ranked processes. The assignment question clear? Question one. Yeah? Anybody who is not able to understand question one? The template in one dot people.
Switch the cluster. Please do not run on login. And you can SSH as yesterday, you can SSH to CN0108. There are 8 endpoints available now. And on Chavok also it's there in the same path. On Chavok you will have to directly run. It's a single mode machine. You have to directly run on that login. MPI run was used, then MPI exit, and then MPI exit got picked up. So this is like, these are process managers, how they handle the MPI run. So this is more efficient. That's
what I will go through some program, and before that I'll like kind of revisit some basic concepts. Because I'm seeing some people are like still having some doubts regarding how MPI is working. So the couple of questions that I had from users here, so I'll answer them again. So before that, I'll connect. Okay, so let me just revisit this send receive program. Okay, so one of the question was like where are the ranks? So if you correlated with OpenMP, so there we know like we have defined a parallel region where threads are created. So where does that happen at MPI level? So it's not happening within the program level. It is happening when we are launching the program. So even if I have a serial program and I do MPI exec, number of process and the serial executable. So I'll have that many instances running at the same time. So I'll have that serial number of serial instances running simultaneously. But they won't be able to communicate to each other. So there will not be any parallelism. There would not be any data or work distribution among themselves. They'll be redundantly running the full program, each and every one, right? So the launcher will launch the serial program as well. Now, when we have the MPI inside that program, so the launcher so when it encounters, so already I have let's say 4 processes running. So I have 4 instances of this program running with me. And when it, when each of these instances they would encounter in it, so MPI environment would be initialized. So MPI environment initialization does a lot of thing at the back end. It initializes your common communication buffer. That's why we see like blocking sends and all for small messages. They can, they don't have to wait. So, and then secondly, your ranks and all would be assigned to different processes, different instances. So rank is assigned to processes, but we don't have their rank known within our program. So we have to retrieve it in certain variable, right? So that's why we call MPI comp rank function to get that value in the in some variable so that we can use it. So comp rank is not assigning the rank to it, it is just retrieving that value. Right? And okay, so you may ask if you have certain doubts again regarding MPI flow. Now, when we have launched this, so all processes have memory address space in which all of these instructions, all of these data elements, they are provided to them independently to each and every process. So now, when they encounter MPI init, a channel is created through which they can talk to each other, and then we must use proper calls, MPI calls, to actually do the communication among these processes. Now, in this given program, so when ranks other than zero, they come, they will execute this. So they'll come to this part, MPI sent, and we can say that they will be waiting there for their intended receiver to receive it. So receiver is here, and once the receiver executes this command call, so then the senders will proceed further. So let's say you comment this receiver and you run the program, so it will compile. Because your compiler doesn't know that whether you have incomplete or not, and but your program would hang. It won't exit because you have a send and you don't have a matching receive. So it's a collective operation. Send will not complete unless and until you matching receive has been executed. Any questions? Okay. So I'll go to the Pi program, and for calculation of Pi, we'll use that numerical integration method, and wherein like area under the curve we use. I hope many people would be aware of that, right? So, so this is the program for calculation of Pi, and here is the function. This is the function here, 4 divided by 1 plus x square. So wherein like this is the function under whose like under which the area we have to calculate, and this will give us the value of pi. So when we have to calculate that area, we divide, we discretize that area into several kind of rectangles or trapezoids, and then we like find area of these respective sections, and then we'll add it. So for that, so my accuracy of my output would depend upon how finer I divide my area into. So how many parts I divide it into. So number of intervals is taken from user, and then so this number of intervals, it is inputted by only one process, right? So we are not reading it from a file, or we are not we don't, the program doesn't know it beforehand because the user has to give it input. So one way is that I write it in such a way that on the command line itself, I pass the input, and inside my I use those command line argument parameters argc argv to retrieve that value so that all the processes would know it. Or the other way is that I do like a scanf kind of function wherein I take that value by one process only. So it would be inside if one process will take it and then it will send it to all others so that others also should know. Right? So rank 0 has taken it, has got the input from user, and then it will send it to others. So here we have a for loop. It is sending to the total number of processes minus, so it is starting from 1. It will start from 1 till rank n minus 1, right? So this is the total number of processes here. And in each call, it is sending. So this is number of intervals. Since it's a scalar, it's a single element, so we pass it by address, right? If you don't pass it, so some of you didn't, while writing the program, you didn't use ampersand for single element, so then it will throw up error. Because it will say that it's incompatible, like int is incompatible with const void and so on. So now in the receiver's side, we receive it. So all other ranks will receive this value. Now we do the actual computation. So my x is 1. So my domain size is 1. So on that x, that I'll discretize into the number of intervals. And I start with sum 0, 0. Sum is for like accumulating the areas of sections. Then I start my this for loop. So this is the work division which is happening here. So it is starting from like 0. So as in the morning you had seen, so this is also happening in a cyclic fashion. So like if I have a number of intervals as, so this is the number of intervals as 100, and we have 10 ranks, so what will happen? One rank 0 will, so rank 0 will pick the first iteration, then the next iteration it will pick is 11th. Right, it is incremented by the number of processes. And so we are distributing the iterations in a cyclic fashion. Now, inside this, I am calculating what x my given iteration corresponds to. So this interval minus 0.5, so this minus 0.5 is to take the middle value of my that section or the trapezoid, so x middle value, and then this is the width of that, and so this gives us the value of x, and then we pass it to the function where we get the value of y, and we sum it. So this is happening at every process side. They are doing for their respective value of x, and then like I am multiplying this x, so I have found the y here inside this summation of all y which were handled by a given process, and then we have to calculate the area, we have multiplied it with width of area. So this is the local partial result with every process. And now since process have created their partial results, now to consolidate them, we need to pass it to some process. And so again, a root will receive it from multiple processes. So here we are saying in a loop, we are receiving it one by one from every process. And in the else part, processes are sending it, right? So this order doesn't matter whether you write thing first or this thing first. So it can be any way. Right? So I can also write if my rank is not equal to 0 here, and I'll write this part here. And this thing I'll write in the else part, right? So that won't affect your program. Any questions? So there is a predefined value inside the program, and it is calculating the deviation with respect to our calculated value. So it is with respect to the predefined, the deviation is this much. So when the interval is 10,000, when the interval is 100,000, so the deviation is lesser, right? And so on. Any question on this? So one of the assignment was to use wildcards in this, like MPI any source, MPI any tag, because where we are receiving inside the for, so here we are receiving. So what is happening that I'll receive in a sequential way from in some particular order from ranks, right? So even though the later ranks, they are ready to send their data, or their data has already been posted, but it's not receiving. It will wait in a certain order to receive from ranks. So here I can put MPI any source, MPI any tag. And many people were asking about like comparison of OpenMP and MPI. So tomorrow also we'll see post lunch. Some comparison. One of the way, like if you have application, you have to select. So it would depend upon like on your expectations. If you see that in some point in future you would like your application to scale on number of nodes and all, so then MPI is the way out. But if you see that you want it for that application for near future only, or it doesn't have that much of data or execution time and it has limited parallelism, so you can go for OpenMP parallelization. And both the programming models, they are quite generic, and they support with them you can express any most of the parallelism types you can express with any of these two models. Thank you.